Let me just start by thanking the Stavros Niarchos Foundation for choosing to have such an important session in the context of this very important conference and inviting us to be a part of this. In the interests of time, I will not introduce each of our panelists. You see their names up on the slide and you can read their bios. Suffice to say that they're a great group of people, experts in their own field, and I'm really looking forward to this discussion. So over the next hour and a half, just a little less than that, we will be having a conversation about the environmental challenges in a region such as the Mediterranean. Now, the Mediterranean, by many writers, of course, has been described as a mosaic of people, of history, as we heard earlier on, of civilizations, of religions, but of course also it's a mosaic of amazing landscapes and seascapes and an amazing biodiversity. And these two aspects, of course, are very closely linked to each other. The Mediterranean Sea in particular is recognized as one of the global biodiversity hotspots. It has a large degree of endemism associated with it. That means species that are found in the Mediterranean are only found, many species found in the Mediterranean are only found in this particular region of the world. So it's a very valuable region, but at the same time, it's a very, very vulnerable region. I like the closing remarks of Professor Aboulafia this morning about the 21st century Mediterranean being broken and in need of repair. A lot of that also applies to the environment in the Mediterranean. If one looks at the threats that the region faces, the environmental threats, it's a pretty long and daunting list. Climate change, eutrophication, desertification, loss of habitat and biodiversity, water scarcity. In fact, a number of studies indicate that looking at the sort of hierarchy of threats and ranking these threats on a global level, unfortunately, actually, the Mediterranean ranks very, very high, if not at the top, for many of these threats. And of course, these threats are linked to a number of drivers. We heard earlier on about tourism and the impacts of tourism on the environment, urbanization, overexploitation of natural resources, overfishing, a very big issue, agriculture, transport, oil and gas exploration. So a lot there, both in terms of the threats and also the drivers that are behind them. And of course, we heard earlier on about the very serious social, political, and economic challenges, crises that the region is facing. So where does this put the environment? What can we actually say about the environmental challenges? In this discussion, we'd like to focus on three sections. We'd like to look at, hold a brief discussion about the challenges themselves, see how they relate to other aspects, other challenges that we're facing in the region, and finally, see where we can go from here, what the future holds for us. So starting on the topic of challenges, perhaps, Michael, I know you've been involved for many years on the aspect of water scarcity. The Mediterranean is one of the driest regions in the world. We have something like 3%, I think, of the world's freshwater resources. Do we really need a crisis to understand the challenge of water scarcity in the Mediterranean, or is there increasing recognition of this?
Well, let me first start by thanking you that picked the word of mosaic in the Mediterranean. It links with the previous discussion. It was always broken, the Mediterranean. And we need to understand that we have this mosaic of solid pieces of immense durability with deep roots, and although we have imprinted differences in our DNA, we still have the Mediterranean picture. And this picture, to a large extent, is due, in my understanding, because of the environment. And this gives an inverted, in inverted commas, this Mediterranean identity. So starting with that, the water scarcity was always an important element of this landscape. And people were very innovative in addressing this. Now, today we have many more challenges because of the differences in lifestyle, so abstraction of water. Imagine that we have, as you said, 3% of the water resources. We have around 180 million out of the 460 million water poor in the Mediterranean. So the area has already problems without refugees, without additional requests because of tourism, and this is an issue. If you bring the climate change challenge into the picture, you have micro and mega challenges. When I say micro, is perhaps in every area where you have abstraction, you have salinization of the groundwaters, but you have also mega problems like in the Nile. You have issues that, I mean, going to the sources of Nile, in the coming years we expect to have a higher flow for some period because of melting changes in the sources, but later on you may expect to have a real crisis in the Nile. And when you bring in the history that was presented by David this morning on sharing the water resources in the Nile, this water issue becomes yet another issue for the stability of the region. Mind you that more than 15 million of people in the Nile Delta live in areas that are few centimeters higher than the level of the sea today. So you have to see all these issues, and also the Mediterranean North, particularly the Adriatic, is water rich, but sub-Saharan Africa, Maghreb countries, Tunisia, Algeria, at the moment already pump from the non-renewable water resources, which is not just living without actually taking care of the future recharge, but also polluting the excellent quality water of this huge resource because of ad hoc management practices. So at the moment we have a serious issue that requires serious action efforts. At the same time, we have the transboundary issue. 90% of the water resources in the Balkans, the rich part of what, are shared. And this is something on which, again, we need to, these are opportunities, all of that. And the final thing I want to say is that in many countries, see particularly Israel, Cyprus, Malta, the solution, inverted commas again, is desalination. But this brings us to another issue, the issue of the nexus between water, energy, food, exactly, and ecosystems. Right. So I stop here, but indeed the water issue, the landscape issue, and the socio-political and particularly the governance required, the governance issues that need to be dealt with are particularly complex, and our decisions for the future, if we have a future, lies exactly on that, on the governance issues.
Simeo, you've been traveling and working all over the Mediterranean in wetlands, but also as an architect, and many times in land planning, many times we've discussed the issue of space. as a challenge, as a resource, a finite resource. Could you tell us a bit more about this?
Space, we have to recognize it as a resource and one of the most important natural resources, which are important not only for humanity and its many activities, but it is also very important for nature, because we have to balance the two. Now, the Mediterranean has been inhabited for a very, very long time, thousands of years. And it's the people that they live on its shores have played a key role in determining the quality of land and of space around the Mediterranean. But these last years, and it was pointed out this morning, we have a great increase of the human pressures on the Mediterranean. These increases started by two innocuous factors. On the one hand, visitors, tourists, and on the other, normal population growth. But tourism is now expanding far too much and draining resources, including land, and population growth is also extremely fastly increasing, both by natural demographics, but also by the movement of populations which are slowly moving towards the Mediterranean as a gateway to Europe. Therefore, the problem of space in the Mediterranean is becoming very critical. Through planning, regional planning, city planning, etc., efforts are being made to use land in a sustainable and reasonable manner. However, this does not seem to be sufficient now at the scale of problems, because land is being taken out of use by many reasons, including large infrastructure construction, but also lately and unfortunately by war. War is the worst thing for the management of land, and it has tremendous impacts. So if we want to face the Mediterranean in a reasonable manner, perhaps the first element is to reduce military conflict in the Mediterranean.
Okay, thank you. Bruce, you've been doing a lot of work and research on ethical challenges in global food policy. We were sharing a report the other day, an FAO report that was really looking at this trend of moving away from a traditional Mediterranean diet of fruits and legumes and more moderate intake of fish and meat, and going really towards a more Western red meat and dairy products.
The McDonald nutrition transition.
The McDonald nutrition transition. Okay.
Dimitri's already basically said it in a nutshell. The relationship between food and energy and water, climate, and the environment is so intertwined, inescapable. When we think about moving one piece, other pieces will start to crumble. For a very, very long time, and this has been a source of pride for the Mediterranean region, the Mediterranean diet has been held out as the most healthful diet. There are many, many debates about this in nutrition, but by and large, the Mediterranean way of eating, the way in which Dimitri has described it, is considered to be very good for human health. It is also, as it turns out, very good for planetary health. It is a very environmentally sustainable way of eating in terms of the impact on the local environment and also in terms of economic well-being for local populations. What is happening is, just as Dimitri has described, more and more people in the Mediterranean are decreasing their consumption of fruits and vegetables. I feel like I'm somebody's new health education teacher in middle school here. You should eat more fruits and vegetables, but you ought to eat a lot of fruits and vegetables, not only for your own health, but also for the health of the planet. Eating more animal source foods, both fish and meat, takes a more significant toll on the environment in a number of ways that are problematic. From the standpoint of ethics and public policy, however, we get into difficult questions about who should tell whom what to eat, and what kinds of policies, if any, should governments put into place when it comes to trying to influence the consumer decisions of individual people. Now, if you layer on top of that the pressures to provide basic, not really nutrition, but basic foods in order to avoid essentially gross malnutrition among very desperately poor people or among migrants, it may seem that this question of encouraging people to eat more fruits and vegetables seems frivolous. But indeed, they're very interconnected. It's important to emphasize that being able to provide not only sufficient calories for migrant refugee populations to ward off real malnutrition, that in order to provide an adequate, not just a sufficient to avoid malnutrition, but an adequate diet for minimal human health, you need to have fruits and vegetables provided, and not only grains. And so we are needing to think about how to produce more fruits and vegetables, eat less meat.
So we've heard about water, we've heard about the diets. Timo's mentioned the land use changes. It seems to all converge, Bob, on the issue of agriculture. And it's a root cause or a root challenge, environmental challenge that the region needs to face?
Well, first of all, the deep history of agriculture in this region is indeed deep. And it's one of the parts of the world where the culture part of agriculture and the role of food in culture has been profound.
Very
and so I resonate strongly with what Ruth has just said. So I think we have to all recognize that agriculture is dependent upon the qualities of the environment. It's dependent upon the whole range of natural resources that we think of when we think of environment. But it also puts at risk those same assets. And you're going to hear me over the course of this conversation probably allude to, and so I'm just going to come out and say it, I think that we are globally, finally, at the abyss, because it is an abyss, of facing up to the fact that Western industrialized agriculture, which we admire, which we build into our basic assumptions about the right way to do things because it's efficient, is a huge challenge and something that I'm going to argue in the more optimistic part of this conversation. Greece has a marvelous, and the Mediterranean basin have a marvelous opportunity to help find the way out of. Soil erosion, water pumping, and the waste of water, greenhouse gases, I'll come back to that in just a minute, the use of plastics, transportation, refrigeration, all the supply chain issues, food waste. There's a whole range of things that agriculture directly threatens, in a way. Biodiversity, the reliance particularly in annual crops on monocultures, less of an issue perhaps in permaculture or long-term perennials, fruit crops and so forth. And then there's a whole range of indirect effects that are environmental, that are caused by land use and other issues, manufacturing, fertilizer production, mining, phosphate is dependent upon mining, the whole issues of labor, both the shortage of it and the increased need for it, because there's a big labor energy trade-off built into our modern way of doing agriculture, the whole question of rural infrastructure, the disinvestment in many parts of the world, including here, I believe, in rural infrastructure, which drives, in a certain way, the incentives toward urbanization. And then there are the whole set of issues that we've already heard a lot about this morning, political instability, mass migration, and so forth. I want to just use a moment, if I may, Dimitri, to just address the issue of climate change in terms of agricultural drivers of climate change. Mm-hmm. There's good news, but there's also some bad news. Let's start with the bad news. Estimates range from 20 to 50%, it really depends on what you count and how you count it, that global greenhouse gas emissions are driven by the global food system. The lion's share is driven by the agricultural production system itself. And then there are smaller elements, particularly notable are fertilizer manufacturing and refrigeration in the downstream chain of moving food from fields and farms to markets. There are mostly vulnerables for agriculture from climate change. We are contributors and we're also really vulnerable. There was some talk a few years back and there were some models run that maybe CO2 enrichment, CO2 fertilization in the atmosphere would somehow promote agricultural production in some crops at least. I think most of us who take this stuff seriously, scholarly and analytical areas are pretty much convinced today that those outcomes were overestimated. So we're dealing with the vulnerabilities. So we have to think about a climate smart agriculture going forward. And as we'll talk in the course of the rest of the conversation, there's some good things that can come from fairly straightforward changes. We don't have to have a whole lot of new technology in order to use what we know to make some progress.
And like you say, the opportunities are there for Greece and the Mediterranean, so we'll come back to that.
Great.
So Mycenae comes from a region that is about two and a half hours away from here, Prespa region. For those of you who haven't visited Prespa, I would strongly encourage you visit it. It's a transboundary region shared by three countries, and Mycenae has had the privilege of living there for the last 25 or so years and has really achieved some great things on the ground together with a team of very committed people. So I really wanted to go to the more local level, albeit transboundary, Mycenae. If you were to think about the region that you've been working in and living in for so many years, what would you consider a critical environmental challenge at this stage in time?
Well, it seems that I represent the areas with a low population, low density population, the areas from people from which people left. Actually, it is an isolated, sparsely populated area, Prespa, which suffered from translocation of people due wars or due migration. So, many years ago, the area has very big environmental, socio-economic problems. And actually, it was a great effort from all the three littoral states to boost development through large development plans, which of course didn't care about the environmental impact, which was huge at that time. But the worst was that all this energy, all these fine funds, and were poured into the area, but the system wasn't there. The society wasn't there, the links between man and nature wasn't there, people were new to the area, so it was not easy for people to absorb and use this, this solution. It is, I think, interesting to point here that the change came from the environmentalists and conservationists who attracted to the area because of the huge environmental problems. And actually all indicators, the socioeconomic, the environmental indicators were very bad. So an external factor, international non-governmental organization working on the environment, came to the area and they tried to solve initially the environmental problems. But very soon, almost immediately, it was evident that we cannot solve any problem without linking it with society and economy. So we started working on these three issues in parallel. Sorry.
Carry on.
And now, if you ask me, and of course, most of the indicators went much better, especially the environmental indicators. And now, if you ask me, which is the biggest challenge now we are facing, is the fact that we have to reestablish the socio-ecological system that was in place. This system, in order to be established, has to go through the society. We had to to work again and reestablish the territorial memory with people at national and transboundary level within a new framework, within the new modern framework. We had to retrieve the traditional ecological knowledge and combine it with research and innovation and modern life. We had to use and see the option of young generation. So now our great, great environmental challenge is to establish this system that will enable local communities to face changes. Mm-hmm. And I would like just to stress that neither society nor environment have the same terminology as they used to. I mean that talking about what is the society, which is a society in Prespa, you cannot confine it in this territory, but also you have people who are intervening and participate in decision making, but they don't live in the area. This is not necessarily bad, but just I want to give you this dimension. And also we have this environmental impact from climate change, for example, which comes from the area. So we need to find our own institutions, to invent our own ways and procedures in order to enable the society to confront all these changes. So I'm afraid that the great environmental challenge comes through the society.
Interesting. Samir, you want to mention something? No?
Sorry.
I was wondering, we mentioned the mosaic and the region being quite a different region. We're talking about challenges in the entire region. Would anyone like to comment on the regional differences that might exist? Michael, you mentioned water. Fisheries, for example, I know in some places, I mean, overfishing is unfortunately a problem throughout the region, but some places are worse than others. Climate change is impacting already some regions more than in others.
Yes. This is a very interesting question, and it has two answers, actually. The characteristics of the region are strong enough to guide environmental characteristics, to guide the countries and bring the countries together. Because of some of the difficulties, some of the minor changes become an excuse for sub-regionality. So we have to be very careful on that. We have to understand the valid argument about differences in the West and East, Mediterranean, North and South. On the other hand, we should not play too much on this sub-regionality because this erodes the efforts at the regional level.
Okay.
And allow me to say a few things about these efforts, because, and philanthropy. My argument is that the Mediterranean was the pioneer of the environment movement. It was started top down by a number of organizations. I want to remind you of CIES, for example, the Commission Internationale pour l'Exploration Scientifique de la Mer Méditerranée, started already in the 19th century and continued in Monaco. The Club of Rome with Aurelio Peccei, Pacem in Maribus with Elizabeth Mamborghese, Equistix with Doxiadis, and I may list many. And this is why, on the establishment of UNEP in 72, the Mediterranean became the flagship and the flagship of the regional seas program. Now, talking about the UN system also before, we are talking in the Mediterranean about something half filled, half empty. I prefer to take the half filled because it is necessary. Although we know the limits with the current sovereign state government-centered UN, we have in the Mediterranean a number of important bodies, like the Barcelona Convention for the Protection of the Mediterranean Sea, with 40 years already, with 7 protocols, with the Mediterranean Commission of Sustainable Development, where NGOs and civil society stands on an equal footing, almost. And this is something that even in moments of big stress and pressures among countries, nobody left the room. So this is an important, but the environment ministries are particularly weak, not only in the Mediterranean, throughout. So the reason why they are all together perhaps was because of the weakness. It was not the Ministry of Foreign Affairs there. Yeah. You couldn't succeed the same. Now, we have, it was mentioned, the Union for the Mediterranean, the Euro-Mediterranean Partnership, which evolving Union for the Mediterranean. There were some very important environmental initiatives. One is the strategy, the water strategy. It was all set, and we disagreed and we stopped over 3 words. Occupied territories about Palestine, or territories under occupation. And because of these 3 words, we stopped and we didn't have the signature. Now we are reviving that through an action plan. And at this very moment, there are discussions on that. This is linked also with many opportunities following the climate, I mean, the COP21 and the foreseen COP22 in Marrakesh. And the options there, particularly about huge projects of solar energy. This is in the future. The environment, the environment for the Mediterranean has played a very important unifying role. And we have to keep the focus to the environment should be kept, also because, as we discussed already, there is a real challenge and a real problem, but also because it gives us a good common goal. So I think these two need to be viewed together, and philanthropy plays an important role here. Most of the initiatives around the Mediterranean are run by NGOs and civil society organizations. So I stop here. The education issue is the most important.
Mm-hmm. We'll come back to that, yeah, okay.
I want to say something for everybody to know, that we are discussing now, we have obtained the Mediterranean strategy of sustainable education for sustainable development, and ahead of us in December will be a ministerial meeting for the adoption of the action plan. Let me say on that how difficult it is, because they were trying to have it under the Union for the Mediterranean, and this was vetoed by one of the neighboring countries just because of the place of the meeting.
I recognize all these initiatives that are taking place, Michael, and I think quite important. At the same time, if you look at the intensity of the threats, the urgency of the issues, one could argue for processes like the Barcelona process that, you know, over the last 20, 25 years, it's been more of a talk shop and less of a concrete action. So, Bob?
So, your question took me in a very different direction.
Please.
And I'll just briefly tell you where it was. The remarkable mosaic of topology, of landscapes, of cultures around the Mediterranean is a beautiful example of how the environmental characteristics and the cultural values shape what people do on the land with regard to producing food.
Precisely.
And fiber.
Yep.
and other things that come from our crops and from our livestock. Fundamentally, agriculture is a place-based activity, and I would say that the mosaic of your question, yes, there's a Mediterranean diet. There's similarities around the area. You recognize, you know, the influences of Lebanon or of Northern Africa or of Southern or Northern Greece or Italy or Spain. You find differences. They're noticeable to the traveler and to the experienced cook, but they also have this wonderful similarity, shared characteristics.
Identity. Yeah.
Identities. I would also say that many of us in the field of agriculture could be plopped down in a particular place that they didn't know before, and they could tell you by what's growing, the latitude or the altitude, which combination
right.
of both that you're at. They could probably tell you something about the annual or periodic precipitation levels. They could tell you something about solar incidents in the area. All of these things will be influenced by climate change, of course. But my point is that the mosaic lends itself to this landscape of diversity and of beauty that is also fundamentally productive. And so that's where your question about mosaic took me.
I'd like to move on to Samuel, please.
There is a paradox here, because we have been saying up to now that environmental problems in the Mediterranean are becoming more and more serious. Climate change is certainly to come. We hope that it will not be as heavy as expected, but it will be a factor. And we can see now already the results in the case of Cyprus, where desertification is starting. There, the country has made the choice of favoring tourism against agriculture, abandoning agricultural cultivations because water is not sufficient for tourism and golf courses. So while we are seeing a situation which is becoming more and more critical, the messages that come from Brussels are more and more negative. 25 years ago, the European Commission played a key role in the Mediterranean concerning favoring a number of activities that were strongly environmental. For example, the activity, the Mediterranean Wetlands Initiative, which started with the support, the strong support, not only financial, but also moral, of the European Commission. The last years, this support to the Mediterranean environment has been dwindling. And the messages that come from Brussels are negative, and they influence the attitude of many countries, because they are seeing that Brussels is not interested. So they consider that perhaps the problem is not as acute as it is felt.
Yeah.
So this is very negative, both environmentally, but also because, as Mike pointed out, collaboration in the environment of Mediterranean countries is a very strong way of building confidence and collaboration among them. And this, unfortunately, is also being shaken. So we have to understand why. It is not clear.
Yeah, I wanted to dwell on this for a while. This issue of environment in the political agenda, I think you're absolutely right, Simeo. We've seen in the last two or three years in Greece, but also in many other parts of the northern Mediterranean particularly, a clear sort of trend towards deregulation, environmental deregulation, a sidelining of what we call the sustainability agenda, and often the perception that the environment is an obstacle to development, or perhaps even a luxury item, or in some cases a finite resource that needs to be tapped to cover, to gain quick quick economic recovery. And we're certainly witnessing that in Greece over the last two or three years. So the question really is, can we afford to put these environmental challenges on hold while we deal with a lot of the other very important crises that this region is facing? Ruth?
No. I mean, the answer is clearly no. We cannot afford to do so, and I would put it in stronger sort of moral terms. We certainly ought not to do so. And there are some very compelling reasons why that's the case, and they actually connect up to some of the more immediate demands and claims that are being made on us from the standpoint of the suffering of people in the migrant crisis and otherwise. So let me try to take two pieces on this and do it quickly, because I know my colleagues have other things they want to add. The argument that is often put forward to defend why we ought to care about the environment and planetary health is an obligation to future generations, that we have an obligation to be concerned about the prospect of a decent life for the generations that come after us, and if we deplete the resources of the planet for our own purposes now, we will leave the children and the children of the children of the future without any way in which to have anything like the decent life that we think everyone is entitled to. The term that's often used is planetary boundaries. We're reaching the end of the boundary of the planet to provide for a decent living experience for human beings. And even if we eke through, or two generations after us eke through, what happens afterwards? One of the problems in the political space with the argument about obligations to future generations, which is a very important obligation and a very important argument, is that it is difficult to maintain empathy. People are just less disposed to be worried about the well-being of generations to come. And also, those generations to come are not currently voting or otherwise responding to governments today. So governments today and regional organizations and global organizations today have an immediate constituency and a concern about their own political futures. The people down the line are not going to determine their political fate. The people now are going to determine their political fate. And that is a serious obstacle to making that first argument work in geopolitical terms or even in national terms. So that takes us to another set of arguments for why we cannot let the environment go, and that has to do with the connection between the health of the planet, the health of the environment, and climate change to current human well-being and current human suffering. So we can make this argument perhaps be a bit more persuasive, particularly in the political arena. First of all, we know that as the climate changes, particularly as it warms, we have real immediate health impacts that are negative, right? Air quality changes, and people have experienced more asthma and more respiratory diseases. Heat increases, and we have more heat-related deaths, heart attacks, strokes, heart disease, and so on. Infectious diseases increase because with warming of temperatures, infectious diseases have more opportunities to develop and spread, and more importantly, and we'll get back to this, with changes in the environment, we have changes in population, which we have talked about all morning, as populations concentrate in urban environments, sanitation, health-related services go down, healthcare services go down, particularly for migrant communities, but also for the communities that have to absorb the migrants. All of this means that the health of people today is very much affected by environmental changes. We also know that the economic well-being of people, very much affected by the state of the environment. As people lose an opportunity for a livelihood because of desertification or drought, they become desperate. They move to places that can't absorb them. We have been talking about this all morning, right? And then we have potentially the prospect of serious conflict. We can discuss this later, armed conflict. And as was already discussed, war is perhaps, and military conflict, the single biggest near-term threat to the environment. So if you put all of these things together, you can make a very compelling and empirically grounded argument why in the near term, okay, if we ignore the environment, we are in fact also ignoring the current human needs of people, and we're adding to human suffering, not only in future generations, which ought to count, but which we have trouble making a politically viable argument out of, but also for the people who are here today. And essentially, summing this up, if we don't recognize that environmental degradation and the mitigation of threats to the environment is not a root cause, right, of human suffering now and of political conflict now, we do that at our peril.
Ruth, you mentioned also the before I pass on to you, Bob, you mentioned the time factor, I think, is very critical. This goes way beyond the four-year election period or the 5 minutes somebody gets on the television. But also, I think the currency with which we measure progress, the currency with which we measure happiness. Thimio mentioned Brussels changing. Well, GDP is the only talk in town, Thimio. So as long as we just look at that as a means of progress, I think that is certainly an obstacle. Bob?
Two quick points. One is, I don't know who it was, but I love the quote, "We didn't inherit the earth from our parents, we are loaning the earth from our children." We are borrowing the earth from our children, which I think is a mindset that is, just that switch in mindset would drive a lot of practical things that people can do even without governments and even without policy. And so I want to go to the point that you asked. Why would it be wrong to put off environmental values and conservation and steps to improve, reinvest in the environmental assets that agriculture depends on? Exactly because what farmers do is both utilize the land and the resources, but they also are fundamentally stewards of the land and those resources. In other words, they have a self-interest in maintenance, if not improvement. And if you have policies around the people who are doing agriculture in a society that de-emphasize or devalue the investment, then it's easy for them to make short-term decisions. Actually, in today's agriculture, a lot of the short-term decisions that good farm management would call for are things that also reduce costs. They happen to be things that, while costly, are damaging to the environment very often. 25% or less of urea and ammonia put on corn and maize in the Midwest of the US actually ends up in biomass. The rest of it is wasted. It ends up in doing bad things to the environment. There's no negative value attached to the cost.
Exactly.
So, I mean, there's a range of things that we should be doing every day that reinforce the quality of the environmental resource that agriculture depends on and forestry depends on and aesthetics depend on, that are simply decisions to do or not do something or to do this instead of that. So degrading the political environment around environmental quality and environmental reinvestment is a big mistake.
Big mistake. Mersini?
Well, I think that this high biodiversity in the area goes along with the cultural diversity.
Absolutely.
And this has increased a lot in our DNA, in our mentality, has increased a lot our flexibility, people that live around the Mediterranean, flexibility and adaptation. And this is something that we certainly shouldn't lose. But the issue is that going towards higher levels of hierarchy and decision making, it seems that people tend to lose their flexibility, they become more rigid and they tend to simplify things and cut things in pieces in order to manage them. However, this is quite far from the degradation and the diversity and the complexity that Mediterranean has. And it seems that we are losing a lot from what we have so far, either in culture or in the environment. And this does not only refer to governments or to people that work with finance, but also it is difficult also for conservationists to see that nature and management of nature shouldn't be treated alone and separate from separation from community and economy. So I think that going towards holistic perspectives is easy to say, but it's very difficult to do it, especially at higher levels.
Especially when you turn it into a political decision-making process. Michael?
Actually, the most difficult problem in the region is its complexity because we have different geometries, political geometries, and different priorities. I mean, if you take and see how much the Arab countries and the League of Arab States contributes to the funding of environmental solutions in the region, you find practically zero. Not because there is no money there, it's because of the priorities within the system. So in the Mediterranean, we have the complexity, we have the uncertainty, we have several other things, and particularly environmental policies and the civil society or environmental NGOs have to address the parallel realities we experience in the region. When I say parallel realities, I mean that I'm going from here to the European Environment Agency, where I represent the European Parliament. When we raise an issue there about the Mediterranean, there is at the same moment a country saying, yes, the Mediterranean is very important, but the Alpic region as well. Another group says, yes, the North Pole, at the very moment. So this is because of one reality within the EU and the fragmentation. The second thing is, we are talking about lack of data. At the same time, we have invested 80 billion in Copernicus, producing 280 million data in 12 hours. Nobody in the Mediterranean has the capacity to assimilate, use this, translate this into policies, and the poor NGOs have to run at all this level to influence, lobby, with no resources, or very, very limited resources. So, one important issue is to support mechanisms of real governance that cut across these realities. And this, I mean, there are attempts. We have at the moment a small, relatively small program, the SWIM Horizon 2020, to capacitate countries. You know how many requests we had from the 8 countries of Maghreb and the Middle East? 600 requests of specific capacity building needs of these countries. We don't have the resources for that. And they pour money in other areas. When you come to the European Investment Bank finances major projects for clean up. If there are less than 50 million, are not interested for them. 100 million more, yes, perhaps. So who is bridging the gap? The private sector, the private banks do not undertake that because of the high risk. So solutions are there, could be, actually. We have to work on that. We have to work for real solutions. And philanthropy, again, could play an important role in bridging, actually, these gaps. And I don't know if we have another round or not. I have, at the end of the day, something because it is, we are near the birthplace of Aristotle. And I want to
save that for the end.
I keep it.
Okay. Save Thimio. Yes.
I wanted to introduce another aspect to this discussion, the question of values, because environment is certainly influenced by the values of each society. Let me give you an example. During 2015, Algeria, which is a rather poor Mediterranean country, declared 10 wetlands of international importance and designated. This shows that the country has some values concerning the environment. The same year, out of the 10 wetlands of international importance in Greece, 8 were in the black list of the convention as undergoing major and serious economical decline, ecological decline. That shows perhaps that our society does not have positive values about the environment. So the question of values is very important. But somebody mentioned in the morning the Wahhabi faith, the Wahhabi Muslim faith. In some of the faiths in concerning Islam, and the Wahhabis are one of them, nature does not have a sacred character. So they are not sensitive, particularly to saving nature or to looking at sites that have a sacred connotation. No, there cannot be any sacred Muslim sites. On the other hand, in Orthodoxy, due to the important initiative and leadership of the Ecumenical Patriarch, Orthodoxy has shown in the recent years a very great interest in nature conservation as part of the creation, and is quite sensitive to these questions. So we have to look a bit on the side of values, and see what they mean.
Yeah, I agree very much, and I think it's important. The examples that you just gave are very good illustrations of a challenge around the environment. Whether or not there is a value to protect and promote the environment is not a universal one. Right? In the same way that, and we return to Aristotle, a commitment to promoting human flourishing is. Right? So one of the strategies, right, for gaining at the level of political discourse, right, common ground around what we would broadly understand to be environmental objectives, is to link the environment to human well-being and to the reduction of human suffering, because there we will have more universal agreement around whether the environment itself is of intrinsic value, which my guess is many people in this room would agree, right? It is not a value that is as broadly accepted globally, or even within countries, among people, as the one that says we ought to prevent human suffering and we ought to promote human flourishing. So that argument tends to prevail more, including, for example, around the kinds of issues that Michael and Robert and Massini are talking about.
I want to allow just a bit more time for interaction with our friends, but before I open the floor, I would like, just like the previous group, let's try and finish off with a bit of hope. I mean, I know the challenges are there. They're very important. All of the trends indicate that things might get worse before they start getting better. But at the same time, I think it is important that we look for optimism. We look for little oases where things are happening. And maybe things can be, those places and those efforts can actually be scaled up to something more substantial. So my main question to the panel is, where can we actually draw our optimism from right now? Massini, perhaps, again, I go to you, because the particular case of Prespa, I think, is very interesting in how this actually worked.
I think there is no chance. There is no chance, but no hope. I mean, yes, we have to hope, we have to work, but we shouldn't be afraid of changes. We shouldn't be afraid of seeing things from another perspective. We shouldn't be afraid of stepping on new roads and new paths that we don't know, especially us who are acting at lower level. And if this will work with the societies, if this will become available and participate in the development of the societies, then what best? But I can't understand how it can be otherwise. I mean, the only way to live is to hope.
The only way is up, yeah. Okay. Samuel?
As things become more and more difficult, I think that we can draw optimism from the fact that more and more people are becoming aware that there are only two choices. The one choice is to go ahead and face the problems and do creative things, and the other is to jump from the window.
Ruth, we were mentioning earlier on, and I was happy to hear it also from the previous groups, the importance of youth.
So there's a part of me that is an optimist, even against the worst of background conditions, and we have some pretty awful background conditions. I would emphasize, and it's, I think, a theme that has come through this morning, and I think will come through in the program overall, that one at least source of hope for the topic of this panel and for the other issues that we are discussing today is with the young people globally, even in very divisive in contexts, even in very hostile political environments, helping young people come to discover for themselves the relationship between certain aspects of the environment, climate change in particular, but more broadly the environment, and how well or poorly people can live, whether people can have a decent life or not. And I think young people, I'm not giving up on the rest of us, but I do think that a lot of emphasis needs to be placed in helping young people understand the connections between food, water, energy, human well-being, and climate, and war and conflict, putting all those pieces together, and giving young people, very young people, children, concrete things to do, very concrete things to do that put them on a path that allows them, you know, there's an old saying, what I believe in is what I do, rather than what I do what I believe in. So the more we can get children and young people to be acting in a way that is going to give us little solutions, and I like very much what you were saying, Sina, about locally based solutions, at the same time that we don't give up on the large geopolitical ones, I think there is the hope there.
So I would just say that that as part of the problem, agriculture presents all kinds of opportunities to address a smarter way to go forward. And I won't go through my ideas in detail. I'm happy to talk with
give us an example.
Folks. Well, I think, first of all, infusing education about environmental services, ecosystem services, environmental dependencies of agriculture in the training and education of future agriculturalists, really, really critical thing to do. That's going to mean, in some places, much more attention to the education of women than is the case in some places. I think for Greece and for the Mediterranean area, stabilizing family-based land ownership and owner producers, resisting through policy the temptations to go industrial. I mean, there are a lot of things that could be done. Let me just take a moment to tell the audience, and maybe a couple of the authors of this paper are in the audience. There's a very interesting paper just out, published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, which shows from paleogenomic studies convincingly that Neolithic Aegeans spread agricultural knowledge by going to what is now Central and Western Europe. So not only did we learn about democracy here, but we also learned about agriculture from Greece and Anatolia. My optimistic view is, once again, perhaps Greece and its people will lead the way to climate smart, locally based, added value, resilience reducing agriculture for a new generation, and will help us all avoid the abyss of industrialized agriculture, which we are, with increasing fuel and other serious costs and environmental degradations, discovering might not in the long term be worth the investment that we've made in it.
I might just add, while we're on agriculture, the marine side of things, the fisheries side
Absolutely.
Of things. Again, the Med being a place of serious crisis of overfishing, but if we're looking at the hope and at the opportunity, if I would compare our job now to 15 or 20 years ago, I think there's a lot more interest coming from the fishers themselves about establishing marine protected areas, about managing, setting up co-management schemes,
stock assessments,
how that can actually link up to regional approaches, such as the General Fisheries Commission for the Mediterranean or the Commission, I think is a challenge. But on the ground, we're seeing a very different situation from what we were seeing 10 or 15 years ago. And of course, most of that is born out of the crisis itself. The people are actually realizing that the stocks have dwindled and something has to give. Michael?
I think that the major opportunity and the reason of optimism comes from the crisis. And both the water crisis and the energy crisis and the climate change. The Mediterranean could become the stronghold of renewable energies. And this will change altogether the picture and the role of the Mediterranean in Europe and the world. But this requires vision and also at the same time support. There are some mega projects that are discussed. We have to be careful because, you know, there are many vested interests there, but this is a real opportunity for the region. This alone is not enough. We need to use the multiple islands of sustainability in the region. And I can tell you that in all countries of the South I have visited very recently, I see improvements in the local environment. We have, you know, a distance from what is happening in the countries. Even in countries that have just recovered from the Arab Spring, you see these efforts. I'm not saying that they are great, I'm not saying that everywhere, but it's not a gloomy picture. It is a positive effort. So I think we need to try and reorient the attention to small and big at the same time and keep going. I mean, the situation, perhaps we have been influenced by the crisis in Greece and we see everything very gloomy, but in fact, the situation is challenging with many opportunities.
Well, the example of Greece on energy is not an example that we would like to follow, but then other countries that have been in a crisis, like Portugal, have moved towards renewables and have not insisted on coal, for example, that we tend
to have
an obsession with. And this is a request
now. This is an international obligation.
Responsibility.
Please, let's open to the floor. Could we have a microphone, please?
It's coming.
I like to take another angle, that there is a lot of guilt for the human being, and we are putting all the blame to the change of environment, which is negative effects. I'm going to give two examples which are facts. The first one is that regarding agriculture, you know that oil now has been produced by using crops. And if you follow up the use of this, I forgot the name of the oil, always I forgot it, it has a certain name, you know.
Biodiesel. Biofuels.
Biofuels. If you just follow up the increase in agriculture and crops used by producing this biofuel, as compared to those which has been supplied to the individuals for food, which should be the usual case, you'll find it has increased significantly much more than it is for the food. Therefore, if you want to continue the analysis, then this means that population increases, the food supply is falling, and this is because you are producing, you are using your mind and technology, you as a human being, you know, to produce biofuels, although there are other sources of energy which you just shut your eyes on it, like the sun energy, for example. Like, you know, the energy, the fuel, the technology for producing oil from the rocks under the sea. Yeah. Now it is improving, but it is improving slowly, not like the crops one. Therefore, this is one example that there is human beings have to be blamed. I mean, they have to change their view and work more on the sun energy, more or less they try to leave this problem. The second example regarding water. Now, as you know, the Mediterranean area are really poor on water. But look at that. You know, the Blue Nile, which our Nile, you know, in Egypt, I'm from Egypt, you know, getting fit. More than 80% of the rain, which is supposed to fall in the Blue Nile, more than 80% of the rains are wasted in the ground. And human beings are looking at that, just take it as a given, you know. And here we'll find that the African countries and the Mediterranean, Egypt are quarreling with the Ethiopia and Sudan, etc. for the world. I believe this should happen. This is mostly happening in other areas, you know, in the world. But because this is the area which I have worked in, and I have documented it, you know. And leaving all that water and say, sorry, we are poor in water, you know. And all this amount of water wasted, you know, it's very bad. Well, in that technology, you know, in one of the visits to the US, I have asked, I'm an economist, therefore I'm not in technology. I have asked some of colleagues, is there a technology? They say, yes, we have come to technology, but it's too expensive to be applied. That's what I want to say. Therefore, optimism is there if we act rightly as human beings. Thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman in the back.
My thanks to the panel for an absolutely fascinating exposition of the challenges to sustainability. My name's Adam Leach. I'm from YCARE International. We work with YMCAs and young people around the world. In the pursuit of establishing common ground, and I think the discussion about hope is both inspiring and helpful. I wanted to make a comment on what Ruth said about current human well-being and health. I think the issue goes beyond just the interests of us all to the interests of young people in particular. I think we're talking about currently massive inequality and the distribution of wealth such that there are large numbers of citizens in poorer countries who are excluded from opportunity altogether. So it seems to me that it's important, and this is not a contradiction or a criticism, it's more affirmation, that we need to see the political choice in this issue. It's not just that young people have rights and entitlements, they must be affirmed and encouraged and supported. I think it's sort of related to that, it's really important in this discussion about the crisis in the Mediterranean. And knowing how serious that is in the Middle East in particular and North Africa, that we don't over-focus on the problems here. I think the spirit of the conversation today has been expansive and creative, and I think it's really important to remember that other parts of the world suffer too and will continue to do so and will continue to drive the problems in the Mediterranean. So the other comment I just wanted to make is that I think that in this discourse about sort of deeper and further and wider and outer, we also need to remember the long term and the importance of how the philanthropy interests can help civil society to sustain solutions and bridge gaps and maintain attention to these kinds of problems.
Thank you.
Comment or
would you like to
I was going to affirm your comment actually and say how much I agree with what you've said and to use this as a moment to make a point I didn't have the time to previously, which is we need to recognize, it is broadly recognized, that when there are crises and when there are impending terrible scenarios in the context of the environment and the climate change concerns. Mind you, I come from a country where major politicians deny that climate change exists, so I have to...
That's a crisis.
That's a crisis of a different sort. That's an altogether different crisis. Imagine what that is like. But that it is almost always the case that the world's most disadvantaged countries and the world's most disadvantaged peoples in countries, even more prosperous countries, suffer the most and suffer first. So that when we are concerned about the least the least advantaged people, the people who are struggling the most, their concerns are very central to discussions about the environment and climate change and agriculture. It's terribly important, huge, when we tend not to focus, for example, on rural poverty, but rural poverty is one of the major locations for some of the worst ways in which people live currently. As people will move into cities, right, because their opportunities to make a living in the rural environment becomes constrained because of environmental and other challenges, assuming we aren't successful with climate smarter agriculture in the way that we hope, the conditions of the world's urban poor are only going to get worse in terms of numbers and in terms of the absolute degradation of their lives. So it's all intertwined.
Oh, sorry. And then I'll take you as a final question. Please?
No.
No.
Oh.
Hello? Yes?
Yes, okay. Perfect.
Thank you. I'm Rosario Sapienza. I'm from the network of the Impact Hub. And I'm very, very happy about this panel. I think is a very interesting one. And I see also a lot of common points with the previous one. I think at the end of the day, we have to change our mindset, as in the previous panel. For instance, we need a new narrative. When you stress about the need of switching from problem to opportunities, I think this is a very important point, and I'm very happy you mentioned that. And I think also that we need, especially for the environment, a mid-long-term perspective. And we need also a translocal or trans-border considerations. And I think these three facts bring us to the realistic conclusion that governments, states, institutions are not the best stakeholders to do that. We need the other bodies to step in. And I'm happy to see that in the panel everybody mentioned philanthropy as a one of the possible solutions for fully filling the gaps. Probably philanthropy also in terms of private sector, in terms of civil society, in terms of citizen, young citizen, and a vast community of practice as we are. And I think for the environment, even more than for the refugees, we have an agenda. What is the right things to do is somehow established, is technically feasible, and is understandable, and we can converge into solution. So what we need is actually the role of who is going to fulfill the gap. So I would like the panelists here a step further, try to tell what philanthropy and what the civil society can do in practice, probably linking local rooted people that already do things into the territory, especially into the borders, with a globally connected community. And I would like you to comment on that, if it's possible.
Well, I'll open it up to the panel, but maybe if I could just take a minute myself, because you mentioned the role of civil society, maybe if we just look at the example of climate change and the good agreement that we had, the good result that we had in Paris at the previous COP. Now that, I think, is an example where civil society obviously played a role at many different levels in creating the pressure with global climate marches throughout the world and in making things work on the ground. I think the private sector also had a very important role in coming forward and saying, yes, the energy future that we are thinking about is not an energy future based on fossil fuels, but it's actually linked to renewables and energy efficiency. But at the end of the day, however way you cut it, it's a political process. And you require the governments to take that decision and to show that leadership. Sure, there's a role for civil society in making that happen. Sure, there's a role for philanthropy in making that happen. But I think let's not ignore that critical role and responsibility of governments in taking things forward. But please.
So a term that I don't think we've used this morning, and it's unusual for it not to be, is entrepreneurship. Mm-hmm. To your point, to several others about education, if there was not a better time for entrepreneurship than today in all kinds of areas, including the creative side, the technical side, the philosophical side. I don't know from my studies of history what time that was. The opportunities are just enormous, and a lot of simple changes made by people who have the power to make those changes,
tipping points.
In what they do, yeah, or what they ask for, or what they demand in the marketplace. Together, collectively, these forms of entrepreneurship can be very, very powerful in changing society. And I think this area, there's the saying, don't let a crisis go to waste. Well, let's not let this one get away from us.
Well said. Michael?
I think philanthropy, you raised it, you explained very well, Dimitris. Philanthropy or the civil society cannot and should not take the role of the government. The government should be strengthened through the activities of the civil society, of NGOs, and they have to take the responsibilities. What is important for philanthropy? Philanthropy is part of the civil society. And what is very important is actually for philanthropy to help and strengthen the institutions within the civil society, the NGOs that have no resources. Actually, the Niarchos Foundation is doing that already very well, but there is more need for that. There is more need because there are no other resources for the different organizations that play this role at different layers, levels, and different, having different tools. So personally, I see the need to have priorities within the civil society menu of activities that have to be supported by philanthropy. And let me say one more thing. Civil society and organizations have multiple roles all the time. I take the issue raised before about water. I didn't mention the non-conventional water resources. Mm-hmm. Non-conventional meaning the gray water, the clean, is an enormous source. It is not only technical issue. In many of the countries of the region, there is a taboo, mm-hmm, cultural or religious taboo in using gray this water. Who is going to help the entrepreneurs or the government in order to introduce this, if not the civil society and NGOs? So there are many layers.
Let's take one final question. I think if there's a lady back there. Sorry, we're just, I can hear the stomachs bubbling all over the place waiting for lunch. Maybe we can continue outside.
Please. Thank you for a wonderful presentation by all panelists. I'm Athena Linos, I'm Greek, and I'm talking as a representative of the Athens Medical School and not Prolepsis. From what I understand, there is no harmonization on environmental law in the Mediterranean countries. And of course, the northern Mediterranean countries follow the European law and get all the directives approved, whereas the southern act differently. The other problem that I can see is that in even northern Mediterranean countries, the emphasis, because it's the interest of the northern European countries, is placed on environmental protection, mainly on air pollution and ground pollution, whereas there are no legal initiatives concerning water pollution, and we are sharing the Mediterranean as a total. So I was wondering, how can civil society or philanthropy advocate changes in the interests of all Mediterranean countries regarding harmonization of environmental law and putting emphasis on water pollution law?
There is law. I mean, we have to make sure that everybody understands. In the non-European Mediterranean countries, there is legislation. There is a lot of legislation, national legislation, most of which is compatible with the European, and we have seven protocols under the Barcelona Convention and several other pieces of legislation. The lack of implementation and enforcement is the issue. And of course, there are also some questions in few standards, but the key problem is with the enforcement of the legislation and the lack of control mechanisms.
Thank you. I think we'll wrap up there because we've already run over time. Thank you very much for your attention, and thank you to the panelists.